Hello students, in my last video we have started with the population interaction. We have seen population interaction is nothing but when two populations or even within a population the organisms are going to be living together, interacting with each other for their survival. There are various types of interactions present, in which the first one was predation, the presence of predator and the prey. Here, the predator is going to be the dominating one who will kill the prey for the food. It will kill and eat the prey. So, predator and the prey, that was the first type of the interaction we studied in the predation. Then, in the predation, we also saw what is the importance of predators and what are the defense mechanisms present in the prey. So that all we have seen into my last video. Today we are going to be starting with the next type of population interaction, and that is competition. Now what do you mean by competition? Competition is going to be when there is going to be one similar type of resource or one single resource, and more than one organisms are going to be fighting for the same resource. For example, here you can see these are going to be the hyena. Now these two hyena, what they are going to be doing is they are going to be competing for the same food resource. This hyena is having this, so this hyena is following it so that it can get this food. So they are competing with each other, so for the survival or for the food. In the same manner, even in this picture you can see that how a lion is going to be fighting with these hyena for their common food, that is, or both of them are flesh eating organisms, so they are fighting for the common resource, that is flesh over here. In short, competition is going to be a process in which fitness of one species is significantly lower in the presence of another species. So whenever a strong one is present, now for example here it is taking and running, so here the fitness of this is going to be lower. Herein the lion is stronger, so in presence of this lion the hyena is going to be having a lower fitness. So that is going to be fitness of one species is significantly lower in the presence of the another species. Always remember, competition is going to be taking nowhere. In competition, both the species are going to be getting harmed. For now example, here you can see that they are competing for the similar resource, but both of them are going to be exhausting their energy. Even here they are losing their energy. Even the lion is losing the energy, even the hyena is losing the energy for the food. So herein, both the organisms, those are going to be competing, are going to be losing the things. So that is, they are going to be undergoing the loss. So competition is going to be a population interaction in which both the competing species will be having the loss. Then next point here, interspecific competition is a potent force in organic evolution. So what is evolution? Monkey becoming man, evolved into man, it is nothing but the evolution. So this change in the organisms for the betterment, you can say, because of the competition only the organic evolution could be possible, it is said. Then competition occurs when closely related species compete for the same limited resource, as I already told you. Then coming to the next point over here, it is not that only the similar organisms are going to be competing. It is not that only the hyena and the lion are competing, or only the lion and the tiger, means same organisms are competing. No, even unrelated species can also compete for the resource. They have given here example is flamingo and fishes. These are the flamingos are birds, and the fishes that are living in water. Both for flamingos and birds, the common food is going to be the zooplanktons. Zooplanktons, you can say, smaller insects that are going to be present into the water. So the flamingos are also going to be eating those, and the fishes are also going to be eating that only. Both are going to be fighting for the common resource. But the birds are totally different, the fishes are totally different, unrelated, but still they are competing with each other. So unrelated species can also compete for the resource. Example, as I told you, flamingos and fishes in some shallow South American lakes compete for the zooplanktons. Then until here we have seen that only if the resources are going to be limited, only then the competition occurs. But it was found out in certain cases that even if the resources are abundant, that is, even if the resources are going to be present maximum, more number of resources are present, even then the competition is taking place. So that type of competition was called as interference competition. So in interference competition, the feeding efficiency of one species is reduced due to the presence of other species, even if resources are abundant. You will understand this interference competition better when we take an example over here. So here is an example, evidence of competition when the resources are abundant. Now what happened? There were something known as Albingdon tortoise. Albingdon tortoise are going to be a species of tortoise. So these Albingdon tortoise were famous and they were found in a particular island known as the Galapagos Islands. So these Albingdon tortoise were found in the Galapagos Islands from many years and they were surviving there happily. But what happened there was, here enough grass was there and enough greenery was there. So what they did was, they introduced some browsing goats over there. The goats were going to be left into that island because goats need grass and green leaves to eat. So how much the tortoise are going to be eating? So what they did was, they introduced these goats into the Galapagos Island. And when they introduced the goats in the Galapagos Islands, it was found out that the Albingdon tortoise totally became extinct within a decade. Means within 10 years after the goats were introduced on the islands, due to greater browsing efficiency of the goats, because goats are eating faster and tortoise are slow eaters. So due to the greater browsing ability of the goats, these Albingdon tortoise got extinct from that Galapagos Islands. So herein we can see, even if the resources are going to be abundant, still because their browsing ability is more, these species got extinct, means they were totally lost from that Iceland. So this is going to be an evidence how even if the resources are unlimited, still the competitions like the interference competition can take place. Then another part over here is something known as competitive release. So competitive release is somewhat totally opposite of the interference competition, you can say. So here in the competitive release, what it says, it is the expansion of distributional range of a species when the competing species is removed. Again, take an example over here. Herein the example is Kernel's field experiments. So in the Kernel's field experiment, what they did? They took two species of your Brancals. Brancals are going to be a type of coelenterates. So something found on the seashore, on the rocks and all, you can find this Brancals. So what they did was, they took two species of Brancals on the rocky sea coast of Scotland. So of the sea coast, on the seashore of the Scotland, two Brancals were present. The name of the Brancals were Balanus and Thalamus. So here we could see that this Balanus and Thalamus were going to be the two species which were present on this rocky coast of the Scotland. But what it was, the Balanus was larger, it was bigger and competitively superior. So the Balanus dominated. In the more space of the rocky coast, this Balanus was going to be present. It covered most of the rocks of the seashore. It was larger and superior. Whereas this Thalamus was going to be smaller, and it was this Balanus was dominating this Thalamus. So this Balanus, wherever it was there, this Thalamus could not develop. So Balanus dominated the intertidal areas and excludes the Thalamus. But in the experiment, what they did, they removed the Balanus from that area. So they specified an area, they took an area and they removed all the Balanus from that area. So when this Balanus, all the Balanus were removed from that area, they found out that this Thalamus, which were smaller, which were weaker, they colonized the intertidal zone. They covered whole of the Iceland. They became dominant over there. So in presence of this Balanus, these were silent, or these were not going to be bringing up their qualities or not growing faster. But when these competitive species, superior species were taken out, then these telomeres were started developing faster. So this was going to be called as the competitive release. It is the expansion of the distributional range. So here the expansion of the distributional range of a species when the competing species was removed. So this, when the competing species is removed, the expansion of the distributional range of this thymallus took place. That is called as the competitive release. Then, coming to the next part in the competition, here we are having something known as Gauss competitive exclusion principle. Now, what is this Gauss competitive exclusion principle? In this, it states that two closely related species competing for the same resource cannot coexist indefinitely, and the competitively inferior one will be eliminated eventually. What was this Gauss exclusion, competitive exclusion principle? According to this, suppose we are going to be having a common resource, and in this common resource we are having the related species. So these related species cannot stay together, and whichever is going to be the weaker one, they are going to be eliminating. So here you can see, they are going to be present on the tree. These birds are found on the tree. But when these red birds are coming on the tree, the yellow birds have to leave the place. So here, the yellow are going to be symbolizing the weaker ones, and red are going to be symbolizing the superior ones or stronger ones. So according to the Gauss competitive exclusion principle, when two closely related species were competing for the same resources, they cannot coexist. They are not able to exist together. But the competitively inferior one, which is going to be the weaker one, it will be lost eventually. This may be true in some cases, but not always. And not always was proved by someone known as MacArthur. MacArthur was a scientist who put forth the theory of resource partitioning, and he said that Gauss competitive exclusion principle may be true sometimes, but not always. Always this is not happening. And herein, whenever, according to the resource partitioning, whenever there are going to be similar type of organisms, they are going to be present together by changing their food habits. So that is going to be resource partitioning. That is, species facing competition may evolve mechanism for coexistence rather than exclusion. So instead of getting totally lost, they may adopt or evolve something known as co-extinction. So let us know more about resource partitioning. So what is this resource partitioning? It is a division of limited resources by species to avoid competition. For this, they choose different feeding times or different foraging patterns. This person is MacArthur. Now let us see what this MacArthur showed. So this MacArthur showed that five closely related species of warblers. So warblers are going to be nothing but small sparrow-like organisms. So small sparrow-like organisms that are warblers, small sparrows only you can say, warblers. He took five different type of warblers. The blackburn warbler, Cape May warbler, black-throated green warbler, then marital warbler, and bay-breasted warbler. Five organisms. You don't need to remember the name of the five, but only understand five closely related species of warblers were living on the same tree. They coexisted. Nobody was lost or nobody was leaving the tree. Both, all the five wanted the same resources. They were living on the same tree, but were not undergoing competition. They were living happily. They were coexisting. So warblers living on a tree could avoid competition and coexist. How? Due to behavioral differences in their foraging activities. Due to behavioral differences in the foraging activities. For example, suppose one bird, that is one type of bird, is coming on the tree for food in the morning. The second will come in the afternoon and to the below side. The third may take food from the bottom. The fourth may take the food from the leaves. It may come in the evening. So in this way, by changing the time of the food and the changing the type of food what they are eating, 5 different species of warblers could stay or coexist together. So that is known as resource partitioning. The resources were divided equally, they were dividing among themselves, and all the 5 species could survive on the same tree. So this proved that Gauss competitive exclusion principle, that they cannot coexist, is going to be only true only for some organisms. But other organisms can coexist by certain differences in their foraging activities. So this was going to be about the competition. So in the competition, we can see that 2 species are going to be competing with each other, in that both the species are going to be undergoing loss. No one is going to get the benefit by competition. If there is going to be something like resource partitioning, share, coexist, only then they are going to get benefit. Competition takes us nowhere. Competition is always leading to the loss of the organism. Both the organisms involved will be under loss. So that is going to be about the competition. Then coming to the next type of the population interaction is going to be parasitism. What is parasitism? So in parasitism, we can see again, there are 2 types of organisms involved. One is the host and second is going to be the parasite. Simplest example of parasitism is going to be your lice, what you call uwa, in your hair. So lice in the hair is going to be the simplest example of the parasitism. So what these lice are going to be doing in our head? They are living on our head and taking our ready-made food. That is, they are going to be taking our ready-made blood, they are going to be drinking. They are going to be totally dependent on us. They are not going to be preparing their food. They are totally taking the food from us. So they are going to be one of the example of parasitism. Herein, this lice becomes the parasite and we become the host. So this is going to be, this type of interaction is going to be called as parasitism. In parasitism, the parasite is going to be benefited because it is getting the ready-made food. So the parasite is going to be benefited, whereas the host is going to be undergoing loss. Why? Because the host is going to be losing. So therein we are going to be seeing that in this type of interaction, the parasite is in benefit, whereas the host is going to be the loss. But herein one beautiful thing that we are noticing is many parasites are host specific. Only they can parasite only a single host species. These lice are found only in human beings and they cannot be found in any other organisms. So lice are going to be present only on human head. So that is host specific. A particular type of parasite is going to be surviving on a particular type of host species only. And the parasite is totally dependent on the host. So suppose if the host dies, even the parasite will die. So they tend to co-evolve. That is, if the host evolves special mechanisms against the parasite also evolves mechanism to counteract them to remain with the same host. Again, coming to this example only, these lice are going to be present on our head. We do so many things to remove it. We scratch our head, we try to take the comb, but they have developed such mechanisms that they are still living in our head. So that is, they are meant to be co-evolved. If we are trying to, how much we are trying to eliminate it, they are also removing that many methods to stay with us. So that is going to be, they are co-evolving with each other, and if the host dies, even the parasite will die. So they are co-evolved and these are having special mechanisms to survive into our body. Other example you can see here, parasitic wasp larvae emerged from a caterpillar. So this is a caterpillar on which these are the parasites, tomato worm, hornworm there is going to be. You can see this plant, even in plants the parasitic plants are present. Let us see that in detail. Here we can see that co-evolution, as I was telling you, as on how the host are developing mechanisms to eliminate the parasite, because if the parasites are going to be present into our body, it is a problem to the body of the host. We are suffering from diseases, or there is going to be itching, or we are going to be losing the blood. So in this way, we are going to be under the loss. So we develop various mechanisms so that the parasites are not living into our body. But to compete with that, even the parasites are getting such evolved that they are staying into our body. What are the adaptations of the parasites? Let us see. Loss of sense organs. Parasites have no sense organs. That is, they don't have taste. They don't have the sensation of the pain, or they don't get the smell. They don't have any sense organs. Presence of adhesive organs or suckers to cling onto the host. Take the example of a leech. So this leech, what it is doing? It is going to be having hooks and sucker like thing. You can take the other example, that is the lamprey. You can take the ascaris that is present into the digestive system. So herein, these have developed special suckers so that they can attach to our body and they can take the ready-made food from the organisms. Then, loss of digestive system. They don't have a digestive system at all because they are getting the ready-made food, already digested food. They are getting from the host. So, loss of digestive system. Unnecessary thing, nothing is present. High reproductive capacity. They are reproducing very fast and many organisms are reproduced. So, high reproductive capacity. So, these are going to be some of the adaptations that parasites have developed to survive in the host. Other than that, we can see that even life cycle of the parasites are often complex. They are having complex life cycle, like they are going to be developing into more than one host also. Example, human liver fluke. Now, human liver fluke is not completing the life cycle only in one organism. This human liver fluke that is there, it is having two intermediate hosts. Human liver fluke, when it is taking birth, it first present in the water. From there, water or the muddy soils. From there, it enters into the snail. This snail is going to be, fish is eating the snail. So, this snail is going into the fish body. Then, when this fish is going to be eaten by some human beings, it enters into the human beings through the fish. So, herein we can see this liver fluke is going to be going into the snail and then the fish to complete its life cycle. So, it is a complex life cycle. Other example, you can take the malarial parasite. Example, you take Plasmodium, which causes the disease that is malaria. So, this malarial parasite, it is going to be present again where? In the water bodies. From there, it is going to be entering into the mosquito, and from the mosquito, it is going to be spreading to other hosts. So, complex life cycle. One thing you remember here, parasites harm the host. Always the host is going to be under the loss. Parasite is harming the host. How? They reduce the survival, population density, growth and reproduction of the host. So, how much of loss it is doing? It can kill the organism, it can reduce its population density, the growth of the organism can be retarded, and even the reproduction of the host is going to be damaged because of the parasite. They make the host physically weak and more vulnerable to predation. So, they make the host weak, and when they become weak, obviously the prey and the predator we have studied, in that predators are always searching for the weaker ones for predation. So, if they are becoming physically weak due to parasitism, they become easily prey to the predators. Then, coming to the types of parasites, we can see that there are two types of parasites present, mainly two types. One is ectoparasite and another one is endoparasite. First one, ectoparasites. So, what are ectoparasites? Ectoparasites, we can see those which are feeding on the external surface of the host. They are not living inside the body, but they are living on the outside of the body. External surface of the host, they are going to be called as ecto. Ecto means outside. They are called as ectoparasites. Let us see example. Examples, lice on humans are the example of ectoparasites. Ticks on the dogs are going to be the example of the ectoparasites. Then we can see that the ectoparasites, that is the theropods in many marine fishes. In marine fishes, we can see they are going to be some insect-like things like called as the copepods, which are attaching to the eye of the fishes. So here you can see this is going to be a type of parasitism. Then other example you can take in the plants. So these are animal. Even in the plants, we can see that the parasitism is present. Example is the cascata plant on hedge plants. So here the cascata plants are going to be nothing but these yellow color things that you are going to be seeing. So these cascata plants have lost their chlorophyll. They don't have chlorophyll. So they, you can see they are yellowish in color. So they don't have the chlorophyll and hence cannot produce their own food. So what it will do? It will wrap to other plants and it is deriving the ready-made food that is being produced by the green plants. So that is an example of the parasitism in plants, that is the cascata. Now here one point to remember is mosquito. Female mosquito drinks our blood, we all know. But this is not considered as a parasite. It cannot be an example of parasite because the female mosquito is drinking the blood only for reproduction. It is not using it as a food. So only female mosquitoes are drinking the blood because they are going to be needing it for their reproduction and not for food. So they are not considered as the parasites. Then second type of parasite is going to be the endoparasite. Endo means inside the body. So parasites that live inside the host body at different sites like the liver, kidney, lungs, RBCs, etc. are going to be called as endoparasites. They live within the body of the organisms and the life cycle of endoparasites are more complex, you can see. They are more difficult, complicated when compared to the ectoparasites. They have simple morphological and anatomical features and high reproductive potential. Examples you can take here, the roundworms, tapeworms, human liver fluke, all these are going to be the example of the endoparasites. Coming to the next one, that is the brood parasitism. It is not a type of parasite, but you can say it is a special type of parasitism seen only in particular type of birds, known as the brood parasitism in birds. Important for 1 or 2 marks, what is brood parasitism? Here, the parasitic birds lay eggs in the nest of its host and lets the host to incubate. Here, what is happening? You take the example, cuckoo and the crow. In the cuckoo and crow, the crow builds the nest. Cuckoo is not building the nest. Only the crow is building the nest. And whatever the ready-made nest is going to be there, in that, the cuckoo will come and lay the eggs. Here, when the crow comes back, it is not able to identify which is going to be the egg of the crow and which is going to be the egg of the cuckoo. And in this way, they have to incubate all the eggs. So, who is under the benefit here? The cuckoo is under the benefit because it is not creating any nest, nothing, but it is getting a ready-made house to lay the eggs. Plus, the incubation of the eggs is ready-madely done by other birds. And plus, during evolution, eggs of the parasitic birds have evolved to resemble the host egg in size and color. So the host bird cannot detect and eject the foreign eggs easily. So what with evolution, what has happened? The eggs of the parasitic bird, means here example, cuckoo bird has become same to look like the crow bird. So the crow cannot identify only which is the foreign bird and which is its bird. So ultimately it has to be incubating all the birds. It will only understand after it is hatched that which is going to be the its bird and which is going to be the parasitic other bird egg. So that is known as the brood parasitism found in certain organisms. Best example is the cuckoo and the crow. So this is going to be about the parasitism. In my next video, we will be studying about the commensalism and the mutualism.